Morning, everybody. Great to see you. Welcome to the second in our series of master classes here at the Chamber Music Lab. I'm Bruce Koplik, the director of the program. Today we are going to play one of the greatest pieces written for piano trio, the so-called Ghost Trio of Ludwig van Beethoven. It was written in 1808, Opus 70. So we'll discuss it a lot afterwards, but let's just start with the performance of the first movement by our fantastic trio, coached by Eugene Kim. So Wesley Zhu, Grant Lee, and Emily Zhu to play the Ghost Trio first movement of Beethoven. Thank you. Last week, we talked about why master classes are important. I just want to review them: performance opportunities, chance to work out your nerves in a friendly atmosphere, chance to get some different perspectives. One thing I left out was that a master class is a chance to hear differing perspectives. So this is a problem for you guys at this stage in your life. You're used to being with your teachers, and they tell you what to do, and if you're a good student, you do what your teachers say. One thing about master classes, and as you grow older as musicians, you're going to have to mediate all kinds of competing opinions, right? And your job as you grow as musicians is going to be to learn what to do with all that conflicting information. So I think you were fantastically prepared, but I'm about to give you some conflicting information. It doesn't mean I think Mr. Kim is wrong. I think he coached you fantastically. But we have an old saying that if you put 100 musicians in a room, you'll get 150 opinions, right? So with that spirit of, I'm going to kind of tear things apart a little bit in the spirit of exploration, but it doesn't mean I don't think you guys are really well prepared, and that the point of view that Mr. Kim provided for you isn't completely legitimate. It's fabulous. Okay, deal? Right? Understood? All right. So this piece comes at a really interesting time in Beethoven's development. It was written in 1808. He was already deaf. And he was in the middle, toward the end of this, what I call the glorious middle period. He wrote these very large-scale, expansive pieces. You know them like the back of your hand. The violin concerto, the emperor concerto, the fourth piano concerto, the fifth symphony, the sixth symphony, the fourth symphony, the seventh symphony. These very, very, that's three opus 59 quartets. Very expansive, large-scale works. And what started to happen as he edged up through the opus 70s and into the opus 90s, by the time he got to the opus 100 pieces, things started to get fragmented. What's so interesting about the Ghost Trio, aside from the stuff about its name, which we can talk about, is that this is the first piece where we really begin to see evidence of the late period. Even though it's technically a middle period piece, it's called a middle period piece, it really begins to show signs like the Opus 95 string quartet, like some of the piano sonatas, Opus 101, certainly by the time you get to Opus 106, where he started really tearing apart the old ideas of how music goes. And the most evident aspect of that in this piece is the wild disruptiveness of it, and the violence of it, and the kind of schizophrenia of it. And what I observe about your performance, which is very typical of the way this piece gets played, it sounds like a real middle period piece that goes along happily, and then the cello plays a nice tune, and you go along. What I'd like to explore with you guys today is more of the struggle, the disruption, the extremes. The dynamic extremes of this piece are amazing. The end of the exposition, and we just play the last 4 bars of the exposition, so everybody remembers. 4 8s. The dynamic marking of those 4 notes is 3 P's. And the next thing we hear is the beginning, which is marked what? Fortissimo, right? I mean, I suppose there could be 3 F's, right? But that's a really, really big dynamic range. And one of the things I think we need to work on today is exploding your dynamic range so that you have the courage to be right at the edge in the fortissimos and very almost inaudible, actually maybe inaudible in the 3 feet. Have the courage to play so softly. There's a fantastic series I commend to you, especially the pianists in the room. you probably all know the famous Hungarian pianist András Schiff. He played the Beethoven Sonata, Piano Sonata Cycle at the Wigmore Hall, and on the Wigmore Hall website is his whole series of masterclasses on the Beethoven Piano Sonatas. It's a fantastic series. And what András Schiff talks about so much is the uncompromising nature of Beethoven's writing, especially as he got later and later and later. And I want to sort of stir you guys out of your comfort zone into some much, much more extreme approaches. Okay? So at the beginning, it's this scream of four, a series of four downward chords, right? Da da dee da 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 bum. And then you play an F natural in a piece in D major. What a shock. Can we just hear the beginning one more time? Play fortissimo, and I'd like you to play a little bit faster. He didn't give a metronome for this piece, but he wrote Allegro con brio, and then in the manuscript, which I've sent around to some of you guys, if you have iPads, he added e con brio, right? First it says Allegro vivace, and then he says e con brio. So clearly, somebody played it, and the implication to play Allegro vivace wasn't quite enough. So he added, in pencil, he wrote it, e con brio. So it's an invitation to play fast. I think probably the same tempo as the Eroica Symphony, which is around the same time. So 60 to the bar. So something like that. Okay? Can we try that? Could you be wilder? Scream it. Scream at Beatrice in the back. Beatrice Afton, who's our good friend, who came to work with us today. Right? Good pencil for it. Play fortissimo. Break the piano. You ever heard that expression? Maybe it's an old expression like I used when I was a kid or my mom used, right? You just grab someone's attention. I want you to grab your colleague's attention more, right? Surprise them. Be more violent. Stand up and do it. Okay, you can't stand up. Dig in. More left hand. With me, I'll give you some cover. Could we sing it to our colleagues here? Right? Yeah, you can sing it. Yeah, that's fine. Okay. Right? So, ready? Well, I'll give you two more. One, two, three. One, two, three. Bum, bum. I didn't hear anything. Come on. Right? One, two, three. One, two, three. Bum, bum. Everybody, right? One, two, three, one, two, three. Looks like you really mean it, right? At the end, okay? Oh, you hate singing. Oh, you just hate singing so much. Maybe we'll have madrigals next year or everything. Right? Okay. All right, now play with that kind of vehemence. Give him, be aware. Dum, bum, bum. If that's a shock. And an even bigger shock, play your F, and then you play D flat. What's that in D major? It's crazy, D flat major. Right? And then you're going to go down to A, and you're going to go up to F sharp, and we're back in D major again. magic, right? But for one moment, we're lost. So you can linger, take your time on the out, don't worry about tempo, shock us with the harmonic change, and then sing your heart, okay? So in three, four bars, we've got these violent changes of mood. It's a little apologetic. The upbeat is everything. Didn't do that. Convey the violence of the moment. Transmogrification of his F, right? And it has everything to do with how courageous you are about waiting for your B flat, right? He was
He was notorious for his temper. Right?
I was going to ask those of you who have the manuscript available to look at the development section. Angry, scratching out in his manuscript. I mean, it's really an insight into his character if you look at the manuscripts. These are so pretty. It looks so easy, right? It looks so simple. Look at his manuscripts, and you'll see what a torture process it was for him to write these pieces. He actually rewrote the whole recapitulation in his manuscript. You'll see he wrote it, and then he started scratching stuff out, and then he put a great big X through the whole thing and rewrote it. So convey this. You know, he was not a happy guy. And he, according to a lot of accounts, he wasn't the nicest guy. And he certainly had a volcanic temper. This is what he's saying about the world. Rage against the world. Imagine if you were deaf. You had no family life. Wouldn't be so nice. But convey that rage. So I really want to hear, let's go from D, da, 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 you know, where you come in forte after triplets, right? And really explode on the participle.
Sorry.
speed of the bow?
Faster.
Mm-mm. Slower. Slower bow, on a cello at least, will make more sound. Right? Arm weight and slower bow. Faster bow will make the sound sound a little skating. Right? So really slow your bow down, put it down by the bridge, and same for you, Willie. Really dig in there. Okay, same place. Right? Warm. Think of forte as being the comfortable end of your speaking voice. Like I'm sort of speaking forte now, right? 10 o'clock, we're talking piano, I'd be talking to you like that. It's not that big a difference, right? I'm talking piano, now I'm talking forte. Now I'm talking fortissimo! Right? Big difference, right? And a little difference in tone. Adds to the depth of the sound. And I
I want you to, don't be apologetic. Don't be a good accompanist. They're playing plenty loud. And our attention is drawn to their scale length. So you really bring that up. So let's go back to I think about those 30-second or 1-minute-long gymnastics routine that you see people do in the Olympics. You have to change gears so many times, and you have to be so precise. It's like the balance beam exercises that Simone Biles and those people do so fantastically. You have to think of yourself in gymnastic mode here, because this requires so much discipline. You played a perfect eighth note. But it's a 16th note. So and it's really hard on a modern piano. You're doing great. But could you be more attentive to the rhythm? Here, let's just go from the piano. We're just tearing this all apart. So A major scales. If you think you want, put the 60s note right on the 25th, right? Do, almost on the beat, right? Okay, same place. Cut the bar in half. G, bomb, bomb, sort of D, bomb, knife's edge. Try to be more incisive dynamically and rhythmically. Alright, same question. Could you pretend you're practicing septic or something? Da 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 da. Completely even, without expression. Don't be so musical, right? Be a little bit more mechanical. Are you listening to the piano? Yeah? Intently? Yeah, okay.
Where is that?
hear the whole exposition.
Can you try to remember all that stuff? Explode out of the gate.
Totally fine.
So you went from
much, much more contrast. Back and forth.
like fight with them, intrude on each other a little bit more. You make a crescendo to the fortissimo, okay? Dum dum forte, and then you're gonna play dum dum la ba 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 fortissimo, and that's the end, right?